how to remove a module from a Soundcraft Ghost console. It's not that difficult. Pretty much all you need is a screwdriver and a socket wrench. It looks like a Phillips head, but it is actually a posi drive. This is a posi number one, and an 11 millimeter socket wrench. It's important for it to have like a tube to it so that it can fit over the knobs and get down to the nut. Now, something I want to show you is that on this one, we have taken some spare nuts and stuffed it full of nuts, and then took a drill bit to drill out the threads. And the reason we did that, leaving it just one nut shy of the top, is so that when you put this on there, you're not scratching the paint of the console with the edge of the nut driver. So if you don't do that, you definitely want to be careful not to put a lot of pressure on it when you're trying to undo these nuts, or you will scratch the paint around the pot nuts. Today I want to take out group 7 and 8. You want to remove the knobs, keep them in a cup or something. Remove the nuts on the pots as well as the screw that holds in the circuit board. This is the posi number one. Looks like a Phillips, but it's a posi. If you use a Phillips, you can get it to work, but your screwdriver will probably skip and cause the head of the screw to get wallowed out and stripped out. Take the nuts off. Now, the circuit board is going to become loose. I'm not too worried about that because on the inside, it is still pretty much held in place by ribbon cables. So it's not like the circuit board is just going to fall out. It'll probably sink into the console. But at this point, it's okay to just go ahead and take all the nuts off. All right, you see that it sank in when I got the last nut undone. All right, so having done that, we can flip the console over and take the bottom off. People ask me, should I take the meter bridge off before I flip the console over? However, if you did take off the meter bridge, then when you turn the console over, all the weight of the console is going to be on these knobs. It's a better idea to keep the meter bridge on. It's going to take the weight off of the knobs. Also, you want to put the faders up so that it's not resting on the faders. I've already got the bottom off. When you take the bottom off, it is, again, the posi drive number one. Something you want to watch out for is that the headphone jack is attached to the bottom. And if you don't know that, you can yank the bottom off and break these wires. So I always take the nut off of the headphone jack and just let it fall inside the console. And again, you want to turn it all the way over to take the bottom off. Otherwise, the weight, the gravity of the, and the weight of the bottom is going to be sagging on these screws as you try to unscrew them. It's going to cause them to bind up. It's better just to turn it all the way over, take the screws out, remove the bottom, and then you can work on it. Be careful about, you know, putting it back down and having something press on these circuit boards. I have these spacers that we made out of, packing foam and 2x4s that allow me to reconnect to power if I need to test it in this position. So here's our group 7 and 8 circuit board loose, but still held in place by the ribbon cables. You're going to want to unplug the fader. Then you want to take off the mother loom connector. And rather than try to fish it out between modules and the mother loom, I go ahead and disconnect it from several modules. So we'll take out a couple of channels around the one I'm interested in to make it easier to access. The master section has a few extra ribbons that have to do with sharing groups and sharing oscillator and talk back across the groups. So I'll just go ahead and undo those. Now the module's almost loose, but it has this white flexi cable that goes down to the rear connectors where the quarter inch jacks are. So so we have to unplug that one as well. And now it should be loose if I got everything unplugged. And there we have it. That's group 7 and 8. One thing to watch out for on these cables, let me just go ahead and pull this one out so I can show you. When they plug back in, they are just slipping into this slot. And you can think it's in, but it's actually kind of cattywampus. It's not straight. Okay, so you want to make sure you are getting lined up parallel, or else it doesn't make good connections. All right, it's just press fit. It stays in pretty good. I wanted to call attention to something ahead of time. When you are manipulating these and trying to get them to fit into the console, you will tend to bump into the other white flex cables. And here's one that has gone cattywampus and got bumped. So, you know, just check them all while you have it open with the bottom off. Let's see about getting this guy back in here. We are going to have to use two hands for this. So I am just going to go ahead and turn the camera off. Okay, so I've got the circuit board in position, but not yet installed. What tends to happen, if you're not careful, is the LEDs won't line up with the holes, and you'll end up with one LED kind of sideways and the rest of them going through the holes. Also, the button caps stay behind the faceplate. So you kind of have to work it in and check that you don't have any button caps that are holding up or LEDs that are holding up and stopping it from going all the way in. But I got to go back to using two hands. Okay, so here I've got the circuit board inserted. I got all the switch caps through. Nothing's binding. All the LEDs are poking through. Faders, the odd groups, go to the connector that is closest to the bottom of the console, furthest away from the faceplate, and the even groups go to the connector that is closer to the faceplate. Flexi cable needs to get plugged back in. These are always kind of the trickiest because it's always dark. You can't really see. You just have to kind of do it by feel. But again, make sure it gets fully inserted and does not cattywampus. Sometimes it helps to have a needle nose plier handy, which I have. And that will help me to get that plugged in. There we go. Double check that you haven't bumped any of the other white flex cables. Everybody is parallel and perpendicular as it should be. And we're good. So when we go to put the bottom back on, we'll have to fish the headphone connector up there before we put all the screws in, and we should be good to go. When you're putting these pot nuts on, they really are kind of hard to get started, and they like to get cross-threaded and kind of go on sideways. You imagine, we have this perfect circle, and then it gets cross-threaded, so it's a little bit sideways. So instead of a circle, it's an oval. And what that does is it squeezes the shaft and makes the pot extremely hard to turn. Here is where this Husky nut driver with spare nuts glued inside really comes in handy, because what you can do, you can like get it to where it's perpendicular, and then you know the nut's going on straight, and then back up like a half a turn or full turn until you hear it click. Hear that click? That's kind of when the thread drops into position, and then you can spin it on. And if it has any resistance, then it's cross-threaded. So again, you kind of get that on there, kind of get it perpendicular, back it up until it clicks, and then just spin it on. And if there's any resistance, start over, because you do not want to cross-thread these nuts. Make sure the pot's still easy to turn, and then you know you got it right. Just collect all the nuts into a parts bin so that they don't get lost. Here we go. Now I have it resting on those posts, and just for safety, I will hook it so that it can't fall. And here's the module that we started to unscrew. It's still held in by the ribbon. And I'm going to unplug the ribbon, and you're going to want to unplug probably 4 or 5 channels on either side so that you can fish the module out in between the ribbons. And then you're also going to want to unplug the fader, which is here. Now be careful when you go to plug it back in. There's a connector here, which is meant for the MIDI computer. This console doesn't have that installed, but I've seen a lot of times for people accidentally plug the fader in here, the fader goes here, okay? And there's also a ribbon cable that goes to the rear connector panel, a little white flex cable. So here's our channel. As we took out the module, we actually knocked another one loose that was right next to it. So when you're doing this, you want to also check your neighboring connectors and make sure that they're plugged all the way in and that none of them are kind of sideways. Now, if you had to take out the rear connector, there is a harness that goes to the meters, the meter bridge connector, and then there is a harness that distributes the group outputs to all the tape sends. So if I were taking this card out, I would unplug these two connectors and then do this ground stud that is soldered to the card and bolted to the frame. So you have to undo this guy, and I will find out what that is and make a highlight right here that tells you what nut driver to use for that nut. On the top side of the console, you would unscrew the nuts and the two screws that are holding the XLR in, and there you go. Module's out. Putting it back in is just pretty much the reverse of taking it out. A couple things to watch for. The fader wires like to get tangled up, so if you can sort of like make sure they're out of the way. Also, the button caps and the LEDs like to kind of get caught under the panel. So you don't want to force it in. If it's not going right in, you want to wiggle it around and manipulate it and try to make sure all the switch caps and LEDs are going through the front panel. And so it's just a little bit of wiggling and jiggling, and oh, we got it. Okay, so we have it in position now. I've got two nuts at either end, just to kind of hold it in position. Check that the switches are all free to operate, nothing's binding, that the LEDs are poking through. And before I put all the knobs back on and everything, I'm gonna hook it up and test in case I have to take it out again. So let's set this up and hook it on. This extra connector is for the MIDI computer, which is not in this console. So don't accidentally plug the faders in here. That won't work. The channel will stay muted all the time and not pass audio. If occasionally you plug it in and it feels like it's fighting against you and it's not clicking down all the way, make sure you don't have a pin bent that is blocking it. Okay, and we're back. Just finished testing this module. Everything's good. And we are ready to put all the nuts back on. Okay, I have the console completely flipped over now to where I'm about to put the bottom on. And a couple things I want to make note of was this center bend, this ridge in the center here that attaches to the bottom. Make sure the wires aren't like crossing over it like this, because you don't want them to get pinched. It's a good idea to tuck this in between a couple modules over here. The power cord, make sure it stays on this side. If you have the MIDI computer, there's actually a metal plate here that shields it, and also has some strain reliefs on it that these ribbons would normally be tied to. So I just like to make sure that that's going to be tucked under there where it can't get over here in the way of the fin to get pinched. Something else to look for is to, at this point, check that all the connectors are latched on. All the little blue ribbon cables, little white ribbon cables, are plugged in firmly and not skewed. And then these ground lugs back here, this is a 7mm nut driver, and make sure those are all snug and tight. We're just gonna put the bottom on and feed the headphone connector and attach that before we screw the bottom down. And let's just put it here for now so it doesn't get pinched. And then we'll be good. So I'm gonna get that bottom on.